You may be seated. Class of 2010, friends and family, welcome to this baccalaureate service, and congratulations on your many accomplishments. To everyone in Page Auditorium, welcome to you also. You may not be presently with us, but you are virtually with us. Thanks for your understanding. Today is a day to be thankful. Let us pray. God of grace and glory, we thank you for the gift of this university, for the wisdom we have gained, the adventures we have had, and the friends we have made. Make us mindful of those who have made our education possible, any who for sad reasons are not here today, and all who lack the opportunities we enjoy. Heal and transform all that has taken place here that we mourn and regret. Open our eyes to what we still have yet to learn about ourselves, humanity, and the world. Help us to treat each new place to which we may move as a new seat of learning, each new friend and colleague as new faculty, and each new challenge and trial as a new curriculum. And fill us with your goodness, your truth, and your beauty, that all whom we meet may find in us a blessing. Amen.
The scripture lesson is from 1 Samuel. Now the Philistines gathered their armies for battle. Saul and the Israelites formed ranks against the Philistines, and there came out from the camp of the Philistines a champion named Goliath of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. He had a helmet of bronze on his head, and he was armed with a coat of mail. The weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of bronze, and his shield bearer went before him. He shouted to the ranks of Israel, "Give me a man that we may fight together." For 40 days the Philistine came forward and took his stand, morning and evening, and David heard him. Now David was the son of an Ephrathite of Bethlehem in Judah, named Jesse. David said to Saul, "Your servant will go and fight with this Philistine." Saul said to David, "You are just a boy, and he has been a warrior from his youth." But David said, "The Lord, who saved me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, will save me from the hand of this Philistine." So Saul clothed David with his armor. Then David said to Saul, "I cannot walk with these, for I'm not used to them." So David removed them. Then he took his staff in his hand and chose 5 smooth stones from the wadi and put them in his shepherd's bag in a pouch. His sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. When the Philistine looked and saw David, he disdained him, for he was only a youth, ruddy and handsome in appearance. But David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied." David put his hand in his bag, took out a stone, slung it, and struck the Philistine on his forehead. The stone sank into his forehead, and he fell face downward on the ground. So David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone. There was no sword in David's hand. Here ends the reading.
America is a nation of 300 million people. We all have one thing in common. We all think we're the little guy. Almost all of us know this story of David and Goliath because it's in the Jewish, Christian, and Muslim scriptures, all three. And it's made its way to the heart of our contemporary cultural imagination. Goliath the Philistine is big, beefy, and belligerent. David the shepherd boy from Bethlehem steps out of obscurity, waves aside the clumsy armor offered him by Saul, the king of Israel, and taking 5 smooth stones and a slingshot, leaves Goliath biting the dust. You can bet that 99% of people who read this story identify with David. We all think we're the little guy. And in movies, athletics, business, and politics, we all feel the pull of that righteous cultural conviction. Stand up for the little guy. Everyone loves the movie where the small town attorney takes on the sprawling multinational conglomerate that's poisoning the water in the local streams. Everyone cries in the final frame of the film when she clenches her fist in victory. We all love to see the small liberal arts college fight through to the final four to take on the big state school powerhouse. It makes everyone feel great. But hold on, let's take a reality check. This is Duke. We did get to the final game of the NCAA, but we weren't the little guy. And we've been to those cultural criticism classes. We know the inspiring movie about the resilience of the little guy has been made by exactly the kind of giant, faceless corporation the attorney in the movie is standing up against. So why do we still say we like the little guy? We want our movies to be about David, but we spend our lives trying desperately hard to be Goliath. We think it's quaint and clever that David got by with 5 smooth stones and a sling, but we spend our own energies stockpiling swords and spears and javelins. We admire the fact that David forswore Saul's shield and gadgetry, but just look at our cars. Just look at our houses. Just look at our country. We've beefed them up to look like Goliath. With so many safety and security features, we can hardly move around in them. You've just spent 4 years of your time and energy, the academic world's best facilities, books and teachers, and a large swath of someone else's money, acquiring the prestigious social and economic entry ticket known as a Duke degree. But think for a moment, why is a Duke degree so coveted? Because it gives you a chance to be Goliath. It gives you the armor. It gives you the weaponry. It gives you the respect. It gives you the acclaim. All the things Goliath had, all the things David didn't have. Here's David, full of confidence, full of faith, full of hope, telling Saul he doesn't need the heavy armor and telling Goliath he doesn't need the mighty power. David defeated Goliath. And what happened next? The people swung behind David. David became king, but it didn't stop there. Gradually, a terrible irony began to take shape. David became Goliath. David became a bully. David became a merciless military power broker. David became a ruthless acquisitor of pleasure and advantage. David became the overblown beached whale he'd begun his career by destroying, just like Elvis Presley, for whom fame and fortune turned gyrating hips into bloated cheeks. David became Goliath. What a tragedy that was. Is that going to happen to you? Are you going to leave this chapel today as David and spend the next 10 or 20 years slowly turning into Goliath? Are you going to make this Duke degree the first of many items of armor so that you look back in a bunch of years' time and wonder whatever happened to the David you are today? Or is there another way? How are you going to avoid losing your soul? That's what we're talking about. When everyone in the world seems to admire and fear Goliath, with all that muscle and armor and big talk, and all your advisors are like Saul saying, "Here's all this armor, you'd better put it on. You're going to need this round here." How are you going to remain true to yourself and what you believe in? Maybe this very moment is the best moment in your life to think about where power really comes from. David's power lies in his five smooth stones. And this story shows us five sources of power: David's power, God's power, and your power. Let's turn those five stones over in our hands together for a moment. Those stones hold the secret of where true power is to be found. Stone number one for David is he's made his peace with ordinary time. He knows how to put his own needs and desires to one side for an extended period to do hard, unglamorous work. That's what David does in the first part of this story. He looks after his father's sheep and takes provisions to various commanders of the army. Some parts of every life and every part of some lives are unrewarding, unregarded, and unattractive. Most of you will doubtless spend some of your life caring for young children, being unemployed, recovering from surgery, doing a job that has no glamour or acclaim. That's when you face one of your life's defining moments. Either you learn the rhythm of the everyday, or you lapse into a sequence of escapist thrills punctuated by hours and days of resentment. David finds a way to make the ordinary into a source of pride, the everyday into a form of training, the mundane into a way to build relationships. That's where he gets his power. Is that where you get your power? Stone number two for David is he's made friends with the outdoor world. David doesn't rely on technology or physical advantage. He's spent his life outside. He knows how to keep sheep. He knows where to find smooth stones. He knows how to craft a sling. Goliath has no idea about these things. If you want to be like David, ask yourself, when was the last time I felt the joy of nature and sharpened my wily wits by spending some time in the fields, in the streams, in the mountains? Have I so surrounded my life with gadgets and comforts and appearances and armor that I've forgotten the skills money can't buy? Some tricks you'll never pick up in an office, a laboratory, or a library. David learns from his outdoor life the wisdom of the owl, the cunning of the fox, the agility of the wildcat, the sharp eye of the eagle. That's where he gets his power. Is that where you get your power? Stone number three for David is he knows himself. Saul assumed David should be as much like Goliath as possible. So he gets out the full set of armor, bronze helmet, mighty shield, coat of mail, hefty sword. But David knows who he is. He knows he's not Goliath. And he knows he's not Saul. If you're feeling burdened and heavy laden right now, is it because you're wearing someone else's armor? Are you trying to be someone you're not and never will be? I wonder if that person you've spent your life trying so hard to please is right here today. How's it working out for you? Strive to be what only you can be. Don't be a second-rate version of somebody else. Not your dad, not your professor, not your sister. Not your friend. God made you the way you are because he wanted one like you. David knows there's no point in putting on Saul's armor. Of course Saul might think he was being disrespectful, taking unnecessary risks, letting him down. But David knows there's no use trying to be Saul. David knows his own weaknesses, and he knows his own strengths. That's where he gets his power. Is that where you get your power? Stone number four for David is he knows who God is. David knows Goliath is not God. Goliath is the reality in front of him right now, and that reality is big, ugly, and intimidating, but David knows what's in front of him is not ultimate reality. Let me tell you another tragedy of this story. How has it happened that Christians in this country have lost so much of the respect and trust of people of other faiths and of no expressed faith? I'll tell you how it's happened. It's happened by Christians turning Jesus into Goliath. And that's a tragedy. Jesus is not a cosmic or political or cultural bully. Jesus is not Goliath. Whatever your view of truth, faith or no faith, Goliath is not God. David knows that. David knows where the secret of the universe lies, and it's not with Goliath. That's where David gets his power. Is that where you get your power? Finally, stone number five. David knows what power fundamentally is. Look at what we've learned from the first four stones. Know time, know the world, know yourself, know God. All being well, these are the things your 4 years of study here have taught you. A Duke education has made you powerful, but where does that power reside? Not in Goliath's bravado, but in David's skill. Not in Goliath's muscle, but in David's faith. Not in Goliath's plausibility, but in David's truth. Not in Goliath's armor, but in David's wisdom. If the last 4 years have taught you what to do with time, how to be in the world, who you really are, and what to believe in, they'll have given you real power. They'll have given you the power of David, a power nothing and no one can take away from you. David lost sight of that power later on. Most of us do, for a season. And when we lose sight of that power, that's precisely the moment when we're drawn to Goliath. In the end, Goliath's problem is not that he's too strong, but that he's too weak. The more we try to become Goliath, the weaker we become. It shows we've lost sight of where true power lies. Class of 2010, treasure this degree. Don't turn it into armor or weaponry to protect yourself or damage others. Treat it as five smooth stones. Let it show you what time, the world, yourself, God, and power really are. Cherish those five stones. Use them wisely. Hold them close to you and hear David whispering to you. You don't need to become Goliath. Bless you, class of 2010. You have a power that Goliath will never know.
Thank you. This is so nice. Everyone's here together, and the end is near, but not too near. That's what I told the Chronicle reporter at the senior barbecue that we were at together about 4 weeks ago in Cameron. Well, class of 2010, here we are all together, but now the end is near. Very near. Very, very near. In fact, your condition is terminal. As the poet W.H. Auden almost said, you thought that Duke would last forever. You were wrong. Then what? Life after Duke. I agree. The concept is utterly, utterly appalling. At the barbecue, I asked one of you what you were going to do next, and he said he was going to be a freshman in the workforce of life. Starting all over again, down at the bottom again, out in the unknown again, and you may be sure there will be no bright-faced fact to carry in and unload your car this time. Want to stick around a little longer? Well, too bad. We have hardened our hearts against you. It is time for you to go. But not to be totally unkind, I have wanted to give you a graduation present. And since I wanted to give something that would be very valuable to you and not terribly expensive to me, I have settled on the gift of wisdom. Several months back, I think I found the perfect thing. As you've read, in recent months, Duke has been exploring a partnership with the city Kunshan, a municipality just west of Shanghai. The city with the highest per capita income in China, Kunshan has been the scene of breathtakingly rapid development. But though it has attracted a lion's share of the world's high-tech industries, Kunshan knows that it lacks something essential to sustain this development, namely high-quality higher education. To meet this need, Kunshan has invited Duke to be its educational partner, an arrangement with major advantages for us. As Duke becomes more deeply embedded in China, we'll be able to help our students understand a culture that will be a major player in your future, and so will better prepare you and your successors for the life of your time. Okay, now I went to Kunshan in January, and when I went to visit, I was taken to a famous tourist attraction that is located there, a beautifully preserved ancient city that has canals instead of roads. It's called Zhejiang, sometimes called the Venice of China. In Zhejiang, I visited the house of a 17th century scholar whose name is known to every student in China, though I confess it was not known to me. This scholar is named Gu Yanwu. In the house of Gu Yanwu, the story's going on a while, I know. In the house of Gu Yanwu, I encountered a famous dictum, and as soon as I came across it, I knew I was fated to share it with you today. Here is my graduation gift to you, a saying from the 17th century scholar Gu Yanwu. Walk 10,000 miles, read 10,000 books. Nice, huh? Walk 10,000 miles, read 10,000 books. 10 syllables, all words you knew by first grade, but like all proverbs, simple words encode a somewhat complicated message. Let me spend a minute or two working it out. To me, this saying proposes an outlook for which there's always more of something stretching out in front of you. 10,000 of them, you know what that means, infinitely many of them, a number you'll never come to the end of. Further, in this attitude, the self propels itself out into the space of possibility in an active way. So the verbs are active or commanding. Walk 10,000 miles, read 10,000 books. So this proverb envisions a mind continually active in expanding the sphere of its understanding. Remember what the proverb was? Walk 10,000 miles, read 10,000 books. I was talking about how it gives the sense that there's an infinitude of something out there in front of you, and that the self is active in propelling itself out there. Walk 10,000 miles, read 10,000 books. So it's a way of envisioning a mind that's continually active in expanding the sphere of its understanding. But what I really found interesting about this proverb is the idea that there are two ways of expanding this understanding, and not just one. On the one hand, this is a command to experience things, to go beyond book learning, to take the infinitely expansive world of human possibility and live it firsthand. Don't just read about it. Get out there. Walk. But the saying also understands that if reading can't be the source of all knowledge, it still is an important source of some knowledge. Humans are the only creatures who have the gift of preserving their understanding in words, of sharing their understanding across time with others through words, and of accessing understanding we ourselves have not achieved by mentally processing the words of others. So in this saying, immediate and word-mediated experience are envisioned as equally necessary, mutually supplementary paths to knowledge, the subject of equally urgent commands. Walk 10,000 miles, read 10,000 books. So you'll be familiar with this idea. You'll know it from things like the Sanford School internships or the Pratt Grand Challenges or a program like Duke Engage. It's the idea that there's a mutually enriching relation between academic learning and engagement with real-world problems. And so I'll just tell you, since you may not know much more about Guyan Wu than I did, Guyan Wu was both a scholar and a soldier. He fought on the losing side in the overthrow of the Ming Dynasty. And his claim to fame was to introduce a version of Confucianism that brought this intellectual tradition into closer touch with economic and political realities and the realities of daily life. I return. Walk 10,000 miles, read 10,000 books. I offer these words to you because you're about to set a course for yourself, and it seems to me these words have some relevance to it. I've met people who, on finishing their education, have snuggled up in some comfortable niche and lived there contentedly without the curiosity to face any new challenges or cross over into new social horizons or learn anything that would require any readjustment of their attitudes or beliefs. You know what people are like who never go anywhere and never read anything. You've met them, I have. At first, we might kindly call such people settled, but after a while, other S words describe them better. Words like stuck, or stalled, or stagnant, or stultified, or stupefying. Amazing how many such words there are. To preserve you from this dreadful alternative, Duke's only wish for you is that you keep moving, that you keep enlarging your world, keep opening yourself to new challenges and prospects, keep using all the modes of your intelligence to integrate new experience into your emerging understanding. You may think I should stand up here and congratulate you for the plans you have made for next year, should you be so fortunate to have made such plans. And if you've got such plans, I do congratulate you, but I do so knowing that even the best step will prove a dead end if you don't travel through that next thing toward options that you can now barely foresee. You might think I should be up here exhorting you to step up to the great problems of your day, global health inequalities or K-12 education or resource depletion or climate change or hyperpartisan politics or creating a financial system that will produce affluence for everybody and risk for nobody. If you can accomplish these things, I promise I will thank you for it. But you will not be a constructive contributor to a single one of these causes unless you first become a certain kind of person. A person who eager to keep learning, to keep advancing from an initial to a deeper understanding. I'm pretty optimistic that you won't be leaving Duke for a swamp of mental torpor. After all, whether you like it or not, this place will have an enduring effect on you. Maybe you've read the book by Malcolm Gladwell called Outliers. In this book, Gladwell proposes that everyone who is ever really good at anything had an unsung prior career, the 10,000 hours of inglorious practice they spent mastering the skill for which they're eventually known. Mozart had to write all the early works of Mozart in order to become the composer celebrated as Mozart. The Beatles played for 10,000 hours in Hamburg to develop the skills that enabled them to eventually emerge as the famous Beatles from Liverpool. Bill Gates started programming in the eighth grade and programmed at least 10,000 hours before he could become the legendary computer whiz Bill Gates. Ryan Zubek, John Shire, and Lance Thomas played at least 10,000 hours of childhood hoops on their way to becoming the NCAA national champions. 12,000? Now let's do the math. You may not have read 10,000 books while you were at Duke, although you may have. You may not have walked 10,000 miles, although you really may have. But you did put in, this is the way I figure it, you probably spent at least 60 hours a week being quite mentally alert for at least 40 weeks a year for four straight years. Do the math, it comes astonishingly close to 10,000. From this, I infer that your Duke career was your time for laying down the foundations of mastery. Mastery of what? Of exactly what I've been discussing, the skills of an active, mobile, many-sided intelligence. Every course you took, every problem you solved, every thought you encountered, every unfamiliar person you crossed over some space to understand, every serious or fun thing you put energy into accomplishing, each of these things by itself and all of these things together were your training for the career that awaits you now, the perpetual push toward broader engagement and deeper understanding that will in fact be your life after Duke. You put in all the hours of practice. Now we send you into the game. According to my unassailable reasoning, you cannot not succeed. From 10,000 hours of drilling, the habits are deeply formed, built so powerfully into your personality that no thinking cessation program could break the addiction. But to be frank, what I just said is not quite true. You've had a wildly stimulating environment around you these past 4 years. And now you're going to have to carry on the adventure with less external support for yourself. And someday, you will face the temptation to stop expanding your mental world, to become addicted to the familiar round, and to form the conclusion that what you then happen to think is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. That day may seem like the day you reach perfect contentment, but it may actually be the day you arrive at perfect inertia, the first day of your new life as a formerly interesting person. On that day, it is my hope that you will feel something itching in you, some survival persisting from your time at Duke, pressing you on you the reminder that there is always more life to live and always more to understand. If you want some words for it, they could be these: walk 10,000 miles, read 10,000 books. My friends, a journey of becoming brought you to Duke. At Duke, you traveled the next stage of that journey. But now the logic of the journey means you have to leave this place to go on with your journey. There's pain in leaving a place and a life you have loved, but this is has the nature of a growing pain. Its opposite would be not pleasure, but rather stasis or even regression. You know, I've worked a lot on the writer Herman Melville. Shortly after he finished Moby Dick, he wrote a remarkable letter in which he says, "Lord, when shall we be done growing?" But he knew the answer, and you know it too. When will you be done growing? If you're lucky, never. To grow is to live. To live is to grow. You filled this place with your splendid life. Now you have to break out of here to get the room to grow some more. Walk 10,000 miles. Read 10,000 books. Keep going. Keep growing. Time to go. Go well.
I invite you to stand. May God give you a tongue to speak the truth and a thirst slaked only by justice. May God give you ears to hear the world's pain and patience to listen to advice. May God give you eyes to see beauty where others might miss it, and perception to see reality from another person's point of view. May God give you a nose to sniff out what's wrong and a longing to put it right. May God give you hands to receive the most precious things life has to give and to cherish them for all their worth. And most of all, may God show you his face and surround you with his love today and every day.